screening. So before we were calculating the splitting at the X point in the band structure of aluminum using the quasi-free electron model, and we had started from the bare Coulomb potential induced by the ions, the aluminum ions, to get this splitting, and we found that it was too large, five times too large. And the main thing that we thought is missing is the screening, that is, this bare potential is reduced by the screening of the valence electron, that is, the electron rearrange in order to reduce and to their negative charge the bare potential. Okay, so for the screening, this is just a reminder. So of what we started last time, the screening, we are talking about the screening by the electrons, and in this case the valence electrons in the crystal. So we had drawn the usual plot of the potential in the crystal, so starting from the bare potential due to the ions charge, that would be a potential that is high peaked and very negative at the position of the ions. And then, okay, can imagine it that way. So there is this bare potential, and it's going to be bare, and it's due to the ions, in this case the charge of the nuclei and of the core electrons. So there is this bare potential, which is in white, let's say. And in response to this potential, the electron rearrange in the crystal, for instance, with some in particular one can expect that they will have a large density where the potential is very attractive, and therefore they will be have a non-uniform distribution, and this is the charge density that I can imagine in my crystal. This is the bare potential into the ions, the superposition of the ions atomic potential. And then, because of this non-constant electronic charge density, there will be a potential. This charge density for Poisson's equation will give rise to Hartree potential, and the total potential will be of a much smoother potential of that type. So because of this electronic charge, there will be also this electron-electron interaction potential due to the charge density here, and the total potential will be the red potential, when the sum of these two potentials will be this red potential. And the overall potential is much smoother than the bare potential, and this is due to the electronic rearrangement, the rearrangement of the electronic charge density in order to reduce the effect of this very sharp potential at the nuclei or atomic positions. So I told you that in principle, in density functional theory, when one solves this for to calculate the electronic structure of a crystal, this is a self-consistent problem that is if one starts from a charge density n of r through Poisson's equation, one has this potential VEE of R, and when injected in the one electron Schrödinger equation, this gives the electronic orbital VE of R. And when one sums the probability density over the occupied state, one obtains charge density n prime, and one has to have that consistency, that is, that this charge density must be the same from the charge density from which we started. So one has to solve this self-consistently. So the charge density determines this potential, and it is also a self-consistency on this potential. If one calculates from the charge density for Poisson's equation, the VPM potential, it must be equal to this one. So the self-consistency can be either on the charge density or on the corresponding potential that is obtained through Poisson's equation. So there is, in principle, numerically, in such calculation, a self-consistency that has to be reached. So we cannot do this numerically here. So what we will do is use a simple model, an approximation, in order to obtain this charge density in response to the ions potential or to the bare potential. And we will calculate by how much this bare potential is reduced compared to what is the ratio between this final potential and the bare potential? That is, what is the screening, the reduction due to the electronic rearrangement? So the model that we will discuss and I will present today is the Thomas Fermi model, which gives us an analytical expression to get for the screening. So Thomas Fermi model. So in the Thomas Fermi model, let's start from this red potential, the potential in the crystal. We assume some potential, so I'm always plotting the potentials here. So this is the smooth smooth potential produced by the sum of these two potential. Let's assume it's like a cosine type of potential. Okay, so this is the potential V of R. And I have a charge density also that I'm doing here. A periodic function that corresponds R2, that is the charge density, so N of R. Okay, so the approximation that one
the
has...
The positive of the B, I should be opposite to that.
Oops, you're right, sorry. Yes, of course. Hopla. This is... here it was right. Okay. All right, so this is the potential that I'm drawing in red. So, okay. So, okay. So, thank you. So this is the potential V of R. All right, so the approximation that one has to make in the top for the validity of this model, so approximation that are needed in the Thomas Fermi model is that this oscillation of the potential, the final potential here, the amplitude of this oscillation are small. The oscillation small. What I mean is that this variation here should be small. Sorry, the delta V. The amplitude of this oscillation should be small. You will see later why this is related to development to first order, that one will make. And the second approximation is that the wavelength of the oscillation, which is typically the lattice parameter. So here we have lattice parameter A, and the wavelength of the oscillation of the oscillation in the charge density and also in the potential A must be much larger than 2 pi over K Fermi. K Fermi is the, H bar K Fermi is the Fermi momentum, and this is, we call it lambda Fermi. So the A parameter must be much larger than the Fermi wavelength, which is the 2 pi over K Fermi. So this approximation is valid in general for the systems for metals, simple metals. The second one is a little bit more the validity is a little bit less good, but we will start from that approximation, and the result one obtains is actually quite sound and gives the main trends of the screen. So, in practice, the second one is less well verified than the first one, but for the sake of simplicity, we make this approximation. All right, so now let's consider a small region in space. Let's consider a region here that is a small box around a point RJ, RI, and we will consider that this box, the dimension D, is much smaller than the period A here. So we consider a point, let's say RJ here, or RI in space, and we look in a small box around this point. Here I exaggerated, this should be very, very small compared to A. So in this region of space, the potential can be considered a constant. So in this region, well, I should have drawn it much smaller, but we can consider the average potential, take a constant. It's going to be a good approximation if D is much smaller than A. So, so we consider a small region of space. Of typical length dimension D, and we take D much smaller than A. So we consider that this D is much smaller than A and is larger than the Fermi wavelength. That is the wavelength at the Fermi energy. And with this, the first approximation, that is, well, the first condition that D is much smaller than A, we can consider that the potential inside the box is a constant. So potential inside the region D or the box, the D region, we can consider that it doesn't vary much. And that it's approximately a constant. So this is fine when D is much smaller than A. Okay, so the first thing we do is to approximate in a small region D the potential here as a constant. And then inside the region D, we will consider that the electrons are approximated, have approximately a free electron behavior. So inside D, we consider that the electron, the valence electron, may be approximated as free electrons. or as a free electron system. And for that we use that D is much larger than the Fermi wavelength. That is when K Fermi is much larger than 2 pi over D, that the wavelength at the Fermi energy is much larger than this typical 2 pi over this typical dimension, then it is a sound approximation to consider that the electron behaves as free electron. That is, the size of the box is sufficiently large so that there are no size effects on the electrons, the free electrons. So that's the approximation we make in the model. Okay? Typically, when this is valid, there are no quantum size effects because the dimension is sufficiently large with respect to the wavelength of the system. Okay, so I need this doing, so I'm going to continue here. So with this approximation, that is considering that our electron in this small box behave like free electron, we can obtain the corresponding Fermi energy with respect to the constant potential, with respect to the average potential. So the Fermi energy in this box is going to be, so for at the position in the box Ri, is going to be what we have derived in the course previously, that is 1/2 for the three-dimensional system, 1/2 3 over pi, 2/3, you can find it in your note, pi square times h bar square over m times the electronic charge density to the power 2/3. In the three-dimensional case, this is what we have.
Does this last condition mean that the Fermi momentum is way far from Brillouin zone? Is it the same?
Yes, it is. It is related to that. Yes.
And since if we are far away from the Brillouin zone, the free electron approximation holds, that's where we take?
It is related. In system, in a box, if the electronic, the oscillation of the wave functions correspond to a wavelength that is much smaller than the typical dimension of the box, then the system is not much perturbed by the boundary condition or by the by essentially quantum size effects. So this is a condition that prevents a significant quantum size effect on the system. Yes, but it is related to that what we have seen also for the free electron system inside the Brillouin. Okay. All right, so now And continuing, so this is the Fermi energy with respect to the average potential. I mean, at the time we had taken as average potential zero in our free electron model. So this is the Fermi energy as a function of the electronic charge density we had for the free electron system. But in our case, there is an average potential here, which is not zero. So the value of the Fermi energy in the system, if you want, this would be delta E, we'll call it. This is the Fermi energy measured with respect to the average potential. So if I want the Fermi energy, this is going to be given by delta epsilon F of Ri plus the value of my average potential. That is, this is the value of the Fermi energy in a system, that is what we had obtained for the free electron system when the average potential, when the potential was zero, the reference potential, and now we have a reference potential which is a different constant, so the Fermi energy that we have in our system is this plus the average potential, okay? In the free electron model, it was measured with respect to a constant which was that we had set to zero. But of course, if we had in our free electron system shifted the average potential by a constant V of R instead of zero, then we would have the Fermi energy at this value plus the average potential, I mean the reference potential. Okay? All right. So my Fermi energy in the box is given by this average potential here, which is the value of the potential at the point R I, plus delta epsilon F, which is this. So this is delta epsilon F that I have here, R I. And my Fermi energy is therefore here epsilon over I. So this is the Fermi energy for in this box. All right? Well, okay. But now if I'm taking another point in my plot, let's say a point here, Rj, then I can make the same discussion. I can take a box of dimension d that is very small, so it's a bit crowded, but so this is the dimension d, so I can have around this other point another box of dimension D, so this would be my red box and then I have around the point Rg a green box, and I make the same discussion, that is I take the average potential which I approximate as a constant, and then I can obtain for this other point also the variation in the free energy which will be given by delta F of, so this was Ri of Rj plus V of Rj. So for the other point, The other point, the density would be smaller, so I would have a smaller value of the delta here, delta epsilon f of Rg, and I will have a Fermi energy here, which would be epsilon f of Rg. Okay, so in this first red box, this is the value of the Fermi energy. In the green box, this is the value of the Fermi energy. But of course, all of this value have to be equal. The Fermi energy must be the same in the whole system. If they are not equal, then they will be charge transfer from one box to the other in order to equilibrate the Fermi energy. So in the end, we must have the condition that all of this Fermi energy must be equal, must be the same. So all of these must be the same in my system at equilibrium. Otherwise, there are some rearrangement, further rearrangement of the charge density. Otherwise, the electron will move to equilibrate epsilon f, the Fermi energy. Okay, is this clear? You agree? So we just, in each of these boxes, we calculate the Fermi energy from the free electron model, but the free electron model had as potential, constant potential, zero. So in order to have the Fermi energy, we have to use the value of the potential in our box plus this value. And then we have to have the same Fermi energy in the different box, because that's the thermodynamical condition. And if it's not fulfilled, there will be some rearrangement of the charge density in order to fulfill this condition. Okay? All right. So we must have the Fermi energy the same in the at each point in our system. And now this gives us an equation. This gives us an equation that is, we must have epsilon Fermi, the Fermi energy at each point in the system, or in each box in the system, that is one half, that is this expression, the Fermi energy with respect to the average potential in the free electron model is given by this term here, one half 3 over pi to the power 2 squared, 2/3, pi square, h bar square over m times the charge density at my point r to the power 2/3. So this is the free electron result with respect to the average potential, and then, or the reference potential, and then we have the potential value here. And this must be a constant for any point R in our system. Okay? So this is going to give us an equation for the behavior of the variation of the charge density with respect to the variation of the potential. So what we will do is to expand this to first order and impose that at first order this condition is verified. It's of course, so what I will do is that I will write the charge density n as n0, a constant, plus a variation of the charge density, and I will do the same for the potential. I will write the potential as a constant everywhere in space, plus a variation. So I'm writing this, and I will expand this to the first order in the variations. And I will impose that this is equal to zero, because I want to have a constant. So I'm writing the charge density this way, the potential this way. So to zero order, this is verified because these are constant, of course. And then what I have to impose is that to first order, this is also verified, so the first order term must be zero. Well, in, on, I mean, all right? Okay.
Sorry.
Yes?
The Fermi energy in this equation.
Yes.
Is it supplied from experimental results, or it has to be calculated separately?
No, no, in this case, I will not use anything from experiment. Okay. Basically, what I'm going to do here is that if a function must be constant somewhere, its first derivative must be zero.
Yeah.
So here I'm doing the same but for a functional. And there what I will impose is that when I expand, okay, you will see, if I expand this, I will have a zero order, the part coming from the constant. I'm assuming this is small, of course, because I'm doing a first order expansion. So to the zero order, I will have a constant in space. To the first order, all terms that will appear to the first order, I will impose that this will be zero, because I want a constant, and therefore to the first order, I have to have zero for what I obtain when I have delta n and delta v. Well, okay, I will write it down, and then you can ask question if it's not clear. So what I will impose is that the first order contribution are zero. And to do that, if I put here my charge density as a constant plus this small change, and I expand to the power 2/3, what I will obtain is n0 to the power 2/3, but I don't care about this because this is the constant, so I ignore it. And then I want the development to the first order in delta n, so this is going to give me 2/3 times n0 to the power 1/3, minus 1/3, times delta n. This is the first order term that will appear when I expand to the first order x plus delta x to the power 2/3. So So what I will obtain is 1/3, 3 over pi of to the power 2/3 times pi squared h bar squared to the power 2 over m. This is an exercise. Okay. So an exercise. 1/3. So I made the term here n0 plus delta n to the power 2/3 will give me n0 to the power 2/3 plus 2/3. N0 to the power minus 1/3 times delta n plus things that are of higher order. Okay, plus O. Okay, if I expand this, this is what I'm going to get to the first order. Right. If it's small, if this is small compared to this, I can always expand to the first order, and this is what I'm getting. So now I'm considering just the first order term coming from this part, and then I will consider the first order term coming from the other part, and I will impose that these are zero. All right, so n0 to the power minus 1/3 times delta n r plus delta v of r. I impose that this is 0. I impose that the variation to the first order of this is 0. So this is what I will impose in order to have a constant behavior for my Fermi energy in space. In all of the boxes, the Fermi energy will be a constant up to first order in the variation of the potential and the charge density. Alright, and this is why I imposed initially that this variation, and this also imposed that the variation in the charge density is small, that they are not large. This is because I want to make a first order expansion. Alright, is it clear? Yes? You have some doubts?
The whole purpose of this problem that we are dealing now is to estimate n of r, right?
Yes. Well, what we want to get an equation which will give us a condition on n of r. From that, what we will get is a condition on n of r, yeah. But that will also, I mean, a relationship between delta n of r and delta v of r. This is what we will get. And this is actually what will replace the self-consistency in the ab initio calculations. That is the fact that the Fermi energy is the same in the whole system is mimicked by this. Okay? And we will get a condition between the charge density and the potential this way. I mean, this replaces the self-consistent problem in the iterative self-consistent problem in the electronic structure calculation. And here we will impose something similar to the first order in the variations of the potential and of the charge density. Okay? All right, so this is the equation we obtain, imposing that the Fermi energy is a constant in the whole system. All right, so now I have a relationship between the variation of the charge density and the variation of the potential crystal on the final potential in my system that includes the electron-electron interaction. So I can rewrite this as 2/3 times 1/2 3 over pi to the power 2/3 pi square times h bar square over m the charge density n0, which is the constant charge density of the or the average charge density in the system, to the power 2/3, and this, okay, I have too many parentheses, so I put a square one here, and then I multiply by delta n of r, and I divide by n0. So I have put a 2/3 here, and I'm dividing by n0 here. And the purpose of all this is that here I'm obtaining the Fermi energy epsilon f0, that is, that will be obtained in the free electron model with this constant value of the charge density. Okay, I'm just rewriting the first term here, and then okay, I have delta V of R is equal to 0. Okay, so now I'm obtaining a condition on the variation of the delta bind the variation of the charge density to the variation of the potential all of this is a constant, and it turns out that this is the value of the Fermi energy in the free electron model of the variation with respect to the average potential for the value n0.
Sorry.
Yes?
In two dimensions, the Fermi energy was not a function of electron density. And will this model work in two dimensions?
No. In two dimensions, it is still depending. It depends in all dimensions on the charge density. But the power is different. So,
constant?
No, this is the density of state.
Ah, yeah, okay.
This is not the same thing. Density of state is a function of the energy.
Yeah.
The charge density of space. Okay, all right. So now the condition we get is delta n. So this condition is delta n of r divided by n0 is equal to -3/2 delta v of r over epsilon 0 or epsilon net of 0, a constant. So basically we have an anticorrelation between the charge density and the potential. If the potential increases, the charge density decreases. And inversely, if the potential decreases, the charge density increases. So we have a relation on the an anti-correlation between the potential variation and the charge density variation, which is this equilibration in the system in order to have a constant permeability. Okay, so this is the first equation that relates the variation of the electronic charge to the variation of the potential, but it still doesn't give us any of the two, but at least we have an equation that relates the two. And then we know also that there is another equation that must relate the two, that is the electronic potential in the, I mean, the, this VEE, or Hartree potential in the system, is generated by the variation of the charge density. So we have another equation relating the potential and the charge density, which is Poisson's equation. So then we will get everything, because we will have two. We have two variables, and we have two conditions, I mean two unknown, and we have two conditions, so we will get each of them. So the contributions, to the potential. That is induced by the electronic charge rearrangement contribution to the potential induced by the electronic charge rearrangement must be given by Poisson's equation. So, just to summarize, we had in our system, we are starting from a known bare potential. The bare potential, the starting potential is known, the one created by the ions. And what we want is the variation of the charge density and the variation of the total potential, or the variation of VEE, the electron-electron interaction potential, in this system. For a given bare potential. So we have already one equation, and the second one is that this potential VEE is created by the variation of the charge density. So now we will write Poisson's equation for VEE, or here I will call it VN because it generated by the charge density m. So the Laplacian of this is Poisson's equation of the variation of this potential n of r is equal to minus 4 pi e square times delta n of R. This potential V delta Vn is the variation of what I was calling in before the electron-electron interaction potential. This is let's see the Hartree potential. Okay, so this potential is created by the variation of the charge density. And this potential V, the total potential V is the bare potential plus this potential Vn or VEE. I call it Vn. So all this, I'm writing the variation because the constant doesn't enter, and just everything is with respect to a constant. The variation of the potential is with respect to a constant, V0, and the variation of the charge density is with respect to a constant, the charge density. But I'm not interested in this constant value. These are just the average values. So the potential is given by this, and I have now the condition that the gradient square of Vn is equal to the gradient square of the total potential here minus the gradient square of the bare potential. And this variation through Poisson's equation is just minus 4 pi e square times delta n, the variation of the charge density. So we have now a relationship between the variation of the total potential and the variation of the electronic charge density. And then we use the other equation. So we have here that delta n is equal to minus 3/2 n0 times delta v over epsilon Fermi 0. So basically, we are almost done. We have a relation, an equation now for the variation of the potential. The only thing is that this delta n and delta v depend on r. So this is much easier to solve in reciprocal space when one has a second, when one has derivatives. The relation, an equation between the derivative and the quantity itself. So this is easier to solve in a reciprocal space. So this is easier to solve in a reciprocal space by writing delta V or V, the potential, as a Fourier series, because it's periodic, so I can write it as V tilde, a coefficient of G times exponential I G R. And now what I didn't consider in this variation is the average value, that is the V tilde of G0. So this is equal to a constant plus this variation of V that I was writing before. So the constant is just the average value. Okay, so now I'm interested if this equation here, if I write it in G-space, in terms of the Fourier coefficient, I'm getting a condition just for each of the Fourier coefficient, and it gives me minus G square delta V tilde of G. So I'm just deriving the potential here, which gives me, because of the exponential, minus g square and each Fourier component. So I'm getting a condition on the Fourier component that is minus g square delta v of g plus g square delta v bar of g is equal to this, and this is 6 pi. I forgot to do if one rewrites this, it is 6 pi e square over epsilon Fermi delta V tilde of G. So the whole thing here then becomes 6 pi. I should have written it before. Okay. Six pi. E square and zero over epsilon Fermi zero times delta V. Okay, all right. Okay, so we have now basically solved the problem. We have the delta V, the Fourier component of the total, the final potential as a function of the Fourier component of the bare potential. So we have the screening.
N0 is not missing here.
Excuse me?
N0. On the right side of the equation. 6 pi e squared N0.
Ah, you are right, yes. I forgot that. Yes.
Sorry, I still mix up the bare potential we call the Coulomb located on each side, right?
The bare potential, yes.
The does it need then the delta in front of it? Delta V there, yeah. Or?
Well, okay. Basically, I'm not considering the G equals to zero Fourier component, because this is the constant part. So I'm caring just about the variation. The variation are creating a variation in the charge density, which is creating a variation in the VEE or VM potential. Only the variations are described in what I'm doing. I don't care about the constant part. Okay? I mean, the constant part is given, that is, for the charge density, it is the average charge density in the system, and for the potential V, it's the average potential in the system, the constant. So I don't care about this one. I'm caring about the variation because it's the rearrangement in the electronic charge density which is going to give the screening. We can start from describing it as a constant, and we want the variation. We know the constant. Okay? All right, so now I'm getting this equation. I can put together the delta V of G, and I'm getting 1 plus 6 pi e square times n 0 over epsilon Fermi. I have to put 0 here. Epsilon Fermi 0 g square. So I divided by g square, and I'm putting this on this side of the equation. So this is multiplying delta v tilde of g, and this is equal to delta v tilde bar of g. So basically, the variation of the potential given by the variation of the bare potential divided by this, which is the screening, which is what is reducing the bare potential because of the rearrangement of the electronic charge density. Now I will relabel this part. I will give it a name. So I will call this constant here Q Thomas Fermi. So, well, actually Q squared Thomas Fermi for dimension purposes. So this is going to be this constant there, 6 pi e square times n0 over epsilon Fermi 0. So this is Q Thomas Fermi square, and so I will be able to write this just as 1 plus Q Thomas Fermi square divided by G square. And if I write here explicitly the Fermi energy in terms of the charge density, so I had this for epsilon Fermi 0, this was 2 Fermi times pi square times h bar square over m and 0 to the power 2 third. So if I replace, because I have also an n0 here, in the end I will get for Q Thomas Fermi 4 times 3 over pi to the power 1 third times e square m over h bar square, h bar square times n 0 to the power 1 third. This is, can check. So, and this actually is just 1 over the Bohr radius. So this is the Q Thomas Fermi just depends on the charge density, and 0 is proportional to n0 to the power 1 third. So the screening depends on the absolute value also of the average charge, valence charge density in the system. Okay, so now we have V tilde of G, the Fourier component of the potential, and I exclude the value g equal to 0. This is equal to 1 over 1 plus q Thomas Fermi squared divided by V squared times V tilde of G. There. So, I have the potential knowing the bare potential, and it is reduced by this quantity because this is equal or larger than 1. We divide by, well, actually it is larger than 1, except for, well, no. When G becomes very large, it's approaching 1, but otherwise this is larger than 1. So, okay, this is always larger or equal to 1. And so it's reducing the bare potential. So just to conclude, give the conclusion concerning the screening in the Thomas Fermi model, which actually are conclusions which are more general. This is a simple model, but it captures the general properties of the screening in the system. That the screening, so these are some conclusions, the screening against the bare potential, if you want external, because we had considered the ions, but you could also assume you put some electric field or an external potential, and the electrons are also going to screen this potential in the same way as it screens the bare potential we considered. So screening against bare external potential, it's reducing in magnitude the potential that is V tilde is smaller than the starting potential, the bare potential, but it typically does not fully cancel the bare potential. Does not fully cancel the bare potential. It reduces it, but it does not normally cancel it. And the screening is more efficient . The electronic screening is more efficient at low G values. That is for large G vectors. Sorry, large wavelengths. So So when the G values are small, this becomes very large, and it reduces drastically the bare potential. And small values of the G vectors correspond to large wavelength. So when the perturbing potential, bare potential, or also an electric field that would have static potential that would have a large wavelength, when one has such a potential, the electrons are able to screen very efficiently the perturbation. So in the limit, in fact, of a constant potential or a potential that is extremely smooth, a smooth electric, for instance, an electric field, the electron can screen that very well. In fact, if one takes the limit G tends to zero, the potential, which is the limit going to a constant potential, the electron would screen it completely. I mean, one cannot take G equal to zero, but taking the limit when it tends to that value, which would correspond to a very, very smooth electric field, then the electrons are going to screen it completely. Okay, so these are the results. Any questions so far? Is it clear? So let me just complete, because we had done all this starting from the calculation of the splitting in the aluminum. So let's finish that part and see what happens with the screening in the Thomas Fermi model for our aluminum splitting. So for the specific case of the aluminum splitting, so for aluminum we had the splitting is given by the splitting produced by the bare potential. This is what we had calculated for a given Fourier component, a given G vectors, which was 4 pi over A 100. So now we can calculate the screening of that Fourier component. So we know that this is going to be a constant Q Thomas Fermi square divided by the norm of the G vector. And in the case of aluminum, for the splitting, we were considering this Fourier, this G vector. So in the splitting involved the Fourier component, and we know how to screen the Fourier component. It's just the Fourier component of the bare potential divided by this. In the case of aluminum, the average charge density N0, it's 3 for the 3 valence electron in the unit cell, divided by the volume of the unit cell, which is A cube over 4. So this is the average value of the valence electronic charge in aluminum. So this is equal to 12 over A cube. This is our N0 that enters the Q Thomas Fermi. So Q Thomas Fermi square is equal to 4 times 3 over pi to the power 1/3, 1 over A0 times N0 to the power of 1/3. And if one puts the value for aluminum here, one gets 4 times P over pi to the power of 1/3. And then I can rewrite this as 12 to the power 3 1/3 times 1 over A divided by A0 times 1 over A0 squared. So I have just put the 12 here and I divided by A0 here and also here. And this is just, if one evaluates this, this is approximately 1.2. And therefore, in the end, with the G vector, the X splitting, one has the norm of this vector in the case of aluminum, 4 pi over A. The norm of this is 4 pi over A square. And this is equal to 4 pi square. I'm writing it so this way. And this is about 2.7. So now the ratio between the two Q Thomas Fermi, which we need, is if one wants this ratio that enters here, then one obtains about 0.4. So in the end, for the splitting, that is for the Fourier the splitting is proportional to the Fourier component, and the Fourier component here will be screened by this factor. So the Fourier component of the total potential for this G vector is given by the bare one divided by 1.4, and so basically the end result is around 0.7 times what we had obtained last time for the Fourier component. So the splitting will be reduced by 30% with respect to what we had calculated. Which is not yet what we had seen from the ab initio calculation, but instead of a factor 5 too large, it's around the factor 3.5 too large. So it's still too large, but at least it has been improved. And okay, this is a model, and so one has the correct trend even far it's not the exact result. There are difficulties. Yes.
The G vector we are considering is it the vector that corresponds to the states that are degenerate?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Yes. So now this is the final part of the story we started. Two lectures ago, that is to calculate the splitting of aluminum at the X point. And the splitting corresponds to the Fourier coefficient of this G vector.
So it's a Fourier coefficient, not the states involved.
Also, I mean, it all starts from diagonalizing the matrix of the perturbation in the subspace of the degenerate state, which are the state corresponding to, it was the G equal to zero and this G vector that were in this subspace. Yeah. And so the difference between this G vector this vector plus or minus 1 with a vector plus or minus 1, and these are the Fourier component that will give the splitting.
What will be the equation for the split? This is for the case that is the splitting of the first pi, because G1 is G0 and we use the non-constant
we found that the splitting was two times the G coefficient.
But how about if the splitting happens not at the how about the splitting at the next bands?
Oh, this other Fourier coefficient. Yeah. So the story the screening would be different. I mean,
okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but do you what G will go into this G here? If for the higher states, for instance, where the G vectors that are degenerate are maybe let's say 1 1 0 and maybe 0 1.
Often you have to consider a different Fourier component of the potential, but the screening. You will still obtain it from the formula I gave you, that is each Fourier component of the final potential, that is the sum of the bare potential and the electron-electron interaction potential, the RT potential, the Fourier component will be that of the bare potential for a given Fourier component divided by 1 plus Q Thomas Fermi square divided by the square of this G component. So this formula that I gave you for the screening is for each Fourier component valid. So you can, depending on which Fourier components is causing the splitting, you know how to screen it. But this is much more general, of course, because this tells you how to obtain the total potential in your crystal starting from a bare potential. Because here you have everything. You have the total potential, and of course the difference between the total potential and the bare potential gives you also this VEE or VN, the potential produced by the electronic charge density, and then from the Fourier component you can also get the change in the charge density. So you have everything basically. Okay.